Let's take a look now at a hypothesis for the median. This is the same data that we've been working with. And we're asking here, is there evidence to suggest that the typical time it takes to complete the quiz is greater than 10 minutes? Now, I use this data for the mean, which we said earlier was actually incorrect, but I'll walk through the process as if it was. And now we're going to walk through the process for the median, which is actually the correct way to go. First of all, I want to identify the parameter. We're interested in the mean, mu, there's no doubt about it. Even though this for academic purposes, we're saying we're doing this for the median, in reality, look at this, we're interested in the mean. When we taking a look at the assumptions, that's going to force us to switch to the median. The other case would be if you were specifically told, like typically medical research, that you're interested in the median, not the mean. Then you'd start off with simply theta. So the null hypothesis would be that the mean is equal to 10. The alternative hypothesis would be that the mean is greater than 10. See, this is the exact same thing we did before, because the processes start out to be essentially identical. And then I'm going to set alpha at 0.05. This is what we'll compare our p-value to. Now the test statistic that we want to use is a t, because we don't know sigma. Now we need to address the assumptions. Now we already looked at a normal plot. The central limit theorem does not apply because here n equals 15. We already looked at the normal plot, and roughly, as I recall, it looked something like this. It was pretty bad. This is definitely gross violations. So as soon as we saw that, we say, okay, this is not normal. And of course, and for my students, you would circle the areas that you're identifying as being a problem. And that tells me right away, I'm going to come up here, and this is now going to be the median. I'm now talking about the median. And the test statistics no longer a T. We'll be using something different. This is based on the binomial. The way we do a hypothesis test for the median is based on the binomial. And what we're going to use is a procedure called the sign test. So I'm going to walk through how to do this in TC Stats, then come back and explain a little bit more about what just happened. So what we need to do is find a p-value. And again, this is based on the sign test. So in TC Stats, when I go to one sample, I see the sign test as an option. I need to enter the null and alternative hypothesis. I'll set this to equals 10. And again, this confidence level is not needed. If you're going to do a confidence interval, then you would need it. But if you're not interested in it, which I really don't care about right now, I'm just going to leave it blank. It knows right now that I'm using quiz times because I have quiz times selected. Then all I have to do is tap update. And there's a bunch of information there. The p-value is 0.0176. Observations above is 12. Equals is 0. Below is 3. The sample median is 12.5. N equals 15. Now I'm going to talk to you in just a moment about what all of these are about. Right now I'm going to emphasize the p-value, 0.0176. That's less than or equal to alpha. Therefore, this next step here, my decision, is to reject the null hypothesis. So if I reject the null hypothesis, that leaves the alternative as being more likely. And my conclusion is that there is enough evidence to suggest the typical time to complete the quiz is greater than 10 minutes. Now, if the p-value were greater than 0.05, let's just pretend here for a moment. Let's just pretend the p-value was 0.062, which is greater than alpha. Then the decision would be to fail to reject. And then you simply say there is not enough evidence to suggest the typical time to complete the quiz is greater than 10 minutes. That's the only difference. If you fail to reject, you're saying, I can't suggest the alternative hypothesis is more likely. And that's exactly what we're going to state here in English. Now, what just happened with this binomial or the sign test? TC stats reported to you the p-value, which was 0.0176. And then it said the observations above were 12 equal were 0, below was 3, and then it gave you the sample median as 12.5 and n is 15. Now, the hypothesized median under the null hypothesis, theta was 10. So this is what's going on here. This is what the sign test does. It takes every data value, compares it to 10. And if the data value is bigger, it records a plus. If the next data value is bigger, it will record a plus. Matter of fact, there were 12 pluses. That's what the 12 means. There were 12 that were above, greater than 10. When it gets a value that is less than, in other words, below, it records a negative. If we have something that's equal, if there's actually a data value equal to 10, it tosses it out. So let's just pretend that there was one value that was equal to 10. That would have given me a 0 rather than a plus or a minus. It would toss it out. It would change n to being 14. So if we're equal, we adjust the sample size. We toss that value out and adjust the sample size because all we're interested in is the number of observations above and below. Now, when this is all done, this is nothing more than a binomial probability. We're looking at 12 above, 3 below. Well, the probability of being above or below is 0.5 because we're using the median. And then this p-value is really nothing more than a binomial probability. So once again, for my students, when you report the p-value, somewhere in there, I want to see all of this. Whoops, there. All of this, everything that TC Stats gives you. Because if you have the wrong answer, the more I have to work with, the more likely I can give you partial credit. So this would help tell me right away, perhaps you use the wrong data set. There's all kinds of stuff that could be happening. So for my students, I need to see all of this. And that's the basis for the sign test. Your textbook goes into a little bit more detail, the more detailed example. So again, just to recap this process, because this process is pretty important. We look at this data, we know that this is actually ratio data. So we know right away we're talking about the mean of the median, pi, the proportion is just doesn't make any sense here. So we start off thinking the mean all the way because people understand that better, unless you actually specifically told through the median. The mean is the way we're going to go. We state the null alternative hypothesis. We specify the significance level. The test statistic, we're thinking T because we don't know sigma. If we knew sigma, we'd be working with a Z. And then we address the assumptions, and we see that the assumptions are violated. If the assumptions were not violated, we continue with a T test. Because they were violated, we switched to the sign test. And we change the null and alternative to now reflect the fact that we're talking about theta, the population median, rather than mu. And then we continue on and get a p-value. Again, this is based on the sign test. It's a p-value from the sign test. And then we state our decision based on the p-value and state the conclusion. Now, just to wrap up the whole thing about alpha again, if the p-value is less than or equal to alpha, then reject. And we say reject, we're always talking about rejecting H0. Otherwise, fail to reject. This is saying, I don't want to write all this out, but I will. If the p-value is greater than alpha, then fail to reject. So looking for is a p-value less than alpha. And again, with the alpha is a probability of a type 1 error. And you're setting alpha to protect yourself from committing a type 1 error. So if you set alpha 0.05, you're saying you think a 5% risk of committing a type 1 error is a reasonable risk to take. So when your p-value comes in less than or equal to alpha, then you're saying the probability of committing a type 1 error is less than or equal to what you said was a reasonable risk. So take the risk. The risk being rejecting the null hypothesis when you shouldn't, that's committing the error. If the p-value is bigger, then you need to fail to reject. We don't want to take that risk. So that's the basic implementation of the p-value and alpha, how they compare to each other and how we use the p-value against alpha to make a decision.